Hello. If you spend much time in the land of Rust, you've probably come across the website Faster Than Lime. I was skimming one of Amos's articles the other week when something caught my eye. Here he makes a new crate with an Axum HTTP server listening on port 8080. He runs this server in a shell, and then in another shell on the same machine, he invokes curl and passes in the address 0:8080. Excuse me, what? This looks like some kind of URL where the 0 is the host name or the IP and the 8080 is the port. According to this, it connected successfully. Now, I don't know about you, but I have never seen this address syntax in my life. He just tossed it in there without explanation, which is rather unlike him, so I assume the intention was just to show off a little trick. So let's have a closer look at this thing. Here I have Ubuntu running under WSL. Let's see if we can reproduce this using another Unixy networking tool like Netcat. Up here I'll run a Netcat listener on port 8080. Then down here I'll try to connect to that listener. Unlike curl, I'll need to specify the port as a separate argument, that is, separated from the host name by a space. Alright, I can connect via 127.0.0.1. This is fine. Now let's try hostname 0, like in the article. What do you know? Works on my machine too. So what the heck is 0? It doesn't look like a hostname. It doesn't really look like an IP address either. To dig a little deeper, let's use strace to find out what Netcat is asking the Linux kernel to do in terms of opening a socket and initiating a connection. What I would expect to see first is a call to the socket syscall. Domain is presumably AFINET, if this is an IPv4 connection. Then there should be a call to connect, which has a couple of parameters. The socket we just made, the destination address, which is contained within this sock adder structure, and its length. In the case of IPv4, this sock adder format contains the destination port, and also the address as a single 32-bit number. You might not have thought about it this way before, but that's simply an efficient way to represent an IPv4 address. The point of the story is that at some point, Netcat is going to reach out to the kernel to connect. Because the request has to match this format, it's going to put some sort of 32-bit number in this destination field, and whatever it is, we can display it like a normal IP address by splitting the bytes and putting the dots between them. Then we know what's really going on when we type 0 as the destination. Let's try that then. Here we see those syscalls logged. First there's socket, as predicted. It's AFINET, so we're using IPv4. Within the IPv4 family, there are multiple protocols available. Here we're using TCP. Now we scoot down to the connect, and strace has helpfully told us that the port is 8080 and the destination is 0.0.0.0. Now, don't be fooled, this looks like an IP address string, but Netcat isn't passing a string to the kernel. strace is just processing that 32-bit number and making it more readable for us. So it appears then that specifying 0 is the same as 0.0.0.0. Let's try 1 instead. Okay, that goes to 0.0.0.1. What about 2? Okay, 0.0.0.2. Let's be crazy, let's go to 1.2. Okay, let's ignore that for now. Let's just worry about 0. Okay, so again, what the heck? We can connect to 0.0.0.0. What does that even mean? Like, at least when you're setting up a listener on the 0 address, it makes sense that it's kind of a wild card for listening concurrently on all interfaces, but you can't connect to a wild card. If you want to connect to something, you have to choose one address, right? To try to answer this question, let's start with the obvious resource, Wikipedia. They have an article for 0.0.0.0 because, of course, they do. So, as a host address, a way to specify any IP address at all when listening, sure. Address when it hasn't been assigned an address yet. DHCP has failed. Target is unavailable. Non-existent target used for ad blocking purposes. It's not really any of these things, is it? Let's scroll down. What's this little thing chilling under references? In RFC 1122, that's a small number, there's something about 0.0.0.0. This host on this network. Interesting. Another way of saying localhost, perhaps. And this RFC is very specific that this address must not be sent, which means that we should never see an IP packet on the wire with its destination set to zero. So it's a little bit weird, but it does seem to have a legit meaning. The host name string 0 is shorthand, which passes as 0.0.0.0, which refers to the current machine, so it targets the localhost interface. Right, so if this is also legit, we should be able to do it in our own Rust code, right? Let's make a project and find out. We're going to use the TCP stream from Rust's standard library and ask it to connect to address 0 on port 8080. If that doesn't work, we'll print an error. Then once we do connect, let's say so and also print out some IP and port information for both ends of the TCP connection that was established. Cool stuff. Let's try running that against our local server. Well then, what's this? Error. No such host is known. Well, that's not good. It sounds like it's trying to do a DNS lookup or something. Let's try instead spelling out 0.0.0.0 explicitly. Ah, a new error. The requested address is not valid in its context. Well, to be fair, that's what I thought too until I read this Faster Than Lime article. Just to make sure I'm not doing something really silly, let me change it to something normal like 127.0.0.1, just for a comparison. Okay, this time it connects to my Netcat listener successfully, so there's something wrong with the zero addresses that I was using just before. You may have noticed that I'm running this code via Rust's MSVC Windows toolchain, while all the tests we were doing before are under Linux. What if we take exactly the same binary crate and run it in the context of the Rust Linux toolchain? Let's put it back to zero first. So let's try that. How about that? The same code fails under Windows and works under Linux. If you were still laboring under the belief that the Rust standard library works the same on every platform, then I'm sorry. Computers are just like this. Now, let's look a little more closely at the output. Notice that both inputs of the TCP connection have the localhost IP address, 127.0.0.1, which has come seemingly out of nowhere. We never specified that anywhere. This jives with what the RFC said, that the zero address means this machine, but that you can't go and use that address in a packet. We know from the strace output that the destination address 0.0.0.0 was supplied to the kernel during the connect syscall. Since it ended up connecting to 127.0.0.1 instead, this decision, this address translation, must have occurred inside the Linux kernel. Since the Linux source code is freely available, we should be able to go and find the code responsible, right? Let's have a go at it. Now, I'm going to remind you all that I am not a kernel developer, and I really don't know what I'm talking about. But at the end of the day, the Linux kernel is just a bunch of C macros, so we should be able to deduce something from reading the code. If I say something dumb, please point it out in the comments. I'm going to start here on this wonderful website, lxr.linux.no, which makes the Linux source code browsable online, and you can click through all the symbols. Relying on a little bit of prior knowledge, the connect syscall would normally be exported as a function called sysconnect, so let's search for that. We can see the prototype if we want, but really we care about the implementation. There's a lot of noise in these, but since we're looking for very basic functionality will look for very basic sounding file names, not this architecture specific stuff. Netcompat.c sounds interesting, but maybe for some compatibility layer rather than the real thing, I don't know. Okay, here's netsocket.c. That sounds promising. This isn't actually a function. It's a big macro. Whatever. Let's go to this underscore one. This looks a bit more familiar. We have our socket file descriptor, a pointer to the destination address in user space memory, and a size of that address struct in bytes. I guess we move that to kernel memory, and if it returns zero, which probably means success, then we go to this sysconnect file thing. Okay. Here it does some kernely looking stuff before ultimately calling some sort of connect operation on the socket. This is kind of like a Rust trait. Ops is a list of function pointers that will be set according to what kind of socket this is. Now, unfortunately, if we try to search for this, this is a complete schmozzle. For this video, I'm going to save us some time and jump straight to the AFINET module, which represents one kind of socket, an IPv4 socket. Here we can see if we're doing a TCP connection, then we're using the set of ops defined by INET stream ops. And if I search for that, then we can see the actual implementation of connect that we're going to end up using, this guy here. So let's click on that. All right, another double underscore thing. I know what to do with this one. Now we're getting somewhere. We've gotten through enough layers of boilerplate that it's actually looking at the address parameter, checking that it's not too small, checking that the family is specified correctly. Now, presumably our socket state at this point is unconnected. And now we're going into another multi-layer dereference to a connect function. But which one? SKPROT. That sounds like socket protocol. Okay, this is some sort of struct proto that we're looking for. Now, if we go back to that table of pointers from before, we have not only the INET stream ops, but also this thing called TCPPROT. Now we're moving into the TCP implementation, so that sounds useful. Beautiful. This is a struct proto, and it has a definition of connect. So that's probably it. Let's keep digging. This will initiate an outgoing connection. I love dot comments. So obviously this is a big complicated function, but what caught my eye here is that there is a variable called datter, which sounds like it could be short for destination address. It initially takes the value of the address that was passed in. Then later down in the function, datter is assigned to a different value, something inside this FL4 struct. Then it's doing something that looks like updating the destination address of the socket. So in the middle here, somewhere, this FL4 gizmo, whatever it is potentially coming up with a different address from the one we started with. Both FL4 and the current destination are passed into this impressive sounding IP route connect function that takes lots of parameters, so let's check that out. Now this is interesting. For the second argument, we passed next hop, which here has been named as the destination. We're treating this entire address as a 32-bit number, like I was talking about earlier. That makes this if case particularly interesting. It's running this code if either the source or the destination address is all zeros, because that will make the 32-bit representation zero. Let's see what this function does. Okay, in a function. A little initialization work, but this looks interesting. The IIF, which I'm going to guess stands for Import Interface, has been set to the loopback interface. That sounds relevant, but if we look at that, then it's clearly not the whole story. That's just setting the IIF index, not modifying the destination IP address. So let's keep going and have a look at this function. All right, lots of logic in here. If the source address is non-zero, run this block. Well, that's not quite what we're looking for. If there is an OIF output interface set, probably not. Ah, what's this? If the data is zero, this is the code we run. First, we set it to match the source address, if we defined one. The Rust standard library probably left it as all zeros, so an appropriate source address will be picked automatically. So at this point, I would expect it to still be zero. Therefore, we hit this next line, and we are updating both the source and the destination addresses to inadder loopback. That sounds familiar. Our 32-bit number for both source and destination has been replaced with this one, which represents 127.0.0.1. Then we set the output interface to be the loopback interface, which matches the change made earlier to the input interface. And there we go, jump to make route. That's it, right there. The reason AMOS was able to connect to 0 port 8080. Well, I think so anyway. This could be totally wrong. Please check the comments. For whatever reason, Microsoft presumably doesn't have the same code in their TCP IP stack. Therefore, the moral of the story is when you're writing your own code, always take the time to write out 127.0.0.1. Then maybe if you're using the terminal interactively on Linux and you want to save some typing, then you could use 0 as a shortcut. That's all for today. Cheerio.